Hi, and welcome to the lecture part that introduces classification and that also introduces classification tasks. So we've already seen regression here in this lecture. Classification is pretty comparable, pretty similar. Many models that we will study in machine learning nowadays can actually handle regression and classification, yeah, by only applying minor changes to the model. As in regression, in classification, we still want to learn assignment functions based on training data that optimally assign an outcome for each observation based on feature values and feature vectors. The main difference to regression is that we are not going to assign a numerical score to each observation, but we are going to categorize each observation into exactly one class. So we're going to assume there's a finite, a finite set of class labels, not too many of them, maybe three, something like red, green, and blue. And we are now going to predict for each observation the specific class that this observation falls into. So a feature vector, or here we have our training data. On the training data, we learn our classifier. Our classifier is a function. And this function takes a vector of feature values and outputs, in this case, a discrete class label. So again, as in the regression, data goes in into the learning process. Out of the learning process comes a function, and this function takes a feature vector and assigns to it a class label. There's a somewhat important formal distinction between so-called binary classification and so-called multi-class classification. That's not very hard to explain. So binary classification simply means that we only having to categorize into two classes, 0, 1, plus 1, minus 1, good or bad, correct or incorrect, sick or healthy, something like this. And multi-class simply means that there's more than two classes. 3, 5, 7, or something like this. And the reason we are making this distinction is because historically, many classification algorithms have either been introduced for two classes, can only work on two classes, or are simpler to define for two classes. So this two-class case is usually a bit simpler to discuss for some methods. So for logistic regression, for example, that we will see later, that's much more natural to define for two classes. Methods like k-nearest neighbor, or for example, a decision tree, they really don't care how many classes there are. And you don't really have to adapt the algorithm at all for being able to work on this case here. So here are a couple of binary classification examples. So we get a feeling for what we could potentially apply such machine learning models to. For example, credit risk prediction. So based on some personal data, based off historical transactions of a couple of people, maybe we want to create an automatic or semi-automatic model that outputs an estimate of the risk for such a person to pay their credit back. Obviously, as a bank, we'd like to model this and be able to kind of get a feeling for whether we should give out this credit or not. And there's spam detection. Based on textual features of emails, we might want to automatically predict whether a certain email is spam or not. And these systems have been running in the background of your email clients or of your email providers now for many, many years. Churn prediction is, again, something from marketing, where based on customer behavior, we might want to predict whether a certain customer is close to terminating his or her contract with us. And if we can predict this, we might want to now give out some benefits to that customer, hit him or her with, some piece of advertisement so we can actually keep them in their contract and continue to make potentially money out of them. And then, there's also, of course, the important field of ja, modeling risks in the field of medicine. So maybe you want to model the predisposition for specific illnesses, yeah, maybe based on genetic data. And here's a more worked out example in yeah, the lower part of the slide here, where we could, for example, automatically try to create a polygraph to detect lies. Yeah? So how would that work? So we have some sensors that measure body changes, yeah, as our subject answers yes or no questions. And then we could record on our computer, I don't know, blood pressure. We could also measure breathing patterns, or we could, through metal plates attached to the fingers, record how much that person is actually sweating. So what we measure is body movements, breathing, perspiration, pulse, and so on. And we could now try to automatically learn a function that, depending on these measurements, outputs a probability whether this person is lying or not for a certain question. Here's an example, again, from the medical domain. That's actually an online example that we copied for automatic medical diagnosis based on certain symptoms. Yeah? So as a user, you can now select the symptoms that you're suffering from, input them into this online graphical user interface. So yeah, maybe you're you have the impression that you're suffering from coughing, you have a headache, you have some nausea, and you can also input your gender and your age, whether you're pregnant or not. And these would be a number of conditions that match your symptoms, and that would constitute potential class assignments based on these input features. And finally, here is probably the most well-known multi-class classification task that exists in machine learning. This is the so-called IRIS dataset. This was introduced by the very famous statistician Ronald Fisher, and was originally designed for was designed as an example dataset for introducing linear discriminant analysis. So this dataset contains measurements on a specific type of flower, the iris flower, and you can see the three subspecies of this flower here. So Setosa, Versicolor, and Virginica. And the dataset is actually so famous that it has its own Wikipedia page that contains a lot of extra background details on the dataset. And what Fisher actually wanted to study is whether it is possible to make a couple of measurements on the flower. So for these petal and sepal components of the flower, he measured their respective width and height, collected this for exactly 150 iris flowers, and also collected their subspecies. So whether it was Setosa, Virginica, or Versicolor. And then he collected this together in a table, and now tried to study whether he can automatically predict which subspecies of this flower it is based on these four measurements. And this is every book or every tutorial on machine learning contains this data set. It's a little bit misleading sometimes for practical work because it's so super simple. So it's a super low-dimensional data set. You can also see that nearly every machine learning algorithm on this data set works very well. There's no missing values, no problems that you have to solve through pre-processing. And this is why so many authors have actually chosen this as an example data set to work on it, because it's so simple to work with. It's also quite nice to visualize. We've done this a little bit already here. So this is a little bit of exploratory data analysis on the IRIS data set. So you can see all of these four features here. So sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. You can see histograms, which are separated by class label. So here, for example, you see the histogram for sepal length, for class setosa, for class versicolor, and for class virginica. And you can also see two-dimensional scatter plots for two features. So here, for example, for sepal length and sepal width. And we have also colorized the 2D scatter plots again by class. And I guess you can kind of easily see how separable these three classes are already just with two features. So yeah, maybe we can, I don't know, take this plot here. It's pretty easy to see that you can kind of separate at least the red class super easily from the other two by using the petal width and petal length feature. And it would all also work out reasonably well for separating the green class from the blue class, again with the same two features. And I guess just by using, I don't know, a pen and a ruler, you could come up with a manually constructed classification system, form a bunch of formulas or two formulas that separate red from the rest, and that also a formula that separates green from blue. But of course, in machine learning, we want to do that automatically. We will also later see how this works with linear discriminant analysis, what Fisher specifically applied on this data set.